Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for the webinar on SOX compliance. My name is Anita Jagesha, and I'm a manager internal audit here at RiskPro India. Now, before we start with the webinar, I'll just take you through a brief introduction of what RiskPro is, and also I'll take you through a brief guidelines about the flow of the webinar today. So to begin with, RiskPro is an Indian consulting and management firm, which is based out of Mumbai. And our main four business verticals are risk advisory, trainings, technology, and recruitment. We've been in the business now for about 8+ years and have about 350+ clients and have presence in 7 cities. And currently our team size is growing and we're currently about 50 members all across India. And we also have associate firm representation in 20+ cities. In terms of the products and services that we offer, as part of risk advisory, we have internal audits, GDPR compliances, SSAE audits. There are also ERM and risk assessments and internal financial controls. With regards to the technology, we have tie-ups with our technology partners for the internal audit software, risk management, legal compliance, insider trading. And just recently, RiskPro has launched a vendor risk management software. For the training, we provide training on various risk-related topics, as well as enterprise risk management, AML, credit and market risk, etc. Now, in terms of the flow of today's webinar, so all the participants currently will be on mute. And if you do have any questions regarding what is being explained during the webinar, I request you to please put in a question in the questions box and we will take up those questions towards the end of the webinar. And in case you do have any issues hearing the speaker or viewing what is being shown, I request you if you could please try re-logging in. And still, if the issue persists, just drop us a line and we'll get back to you and look into what the issue is. So I'll now hand over to Rekha, who will be conducting the presentation for the SOX webinar. Yes, Rekha, you may begin.
Thanks, everyone. We would be starting the webinar with Ashish. So Ashish, I hope you can see the screen and you could start the session.
Yeah, thank you, Rekha. Hello, everyone. Firstly, Rekha and I would like to thank you for joining in today's webinar on Sarbanes-Oxley compliance. This webinar is for 1 hour and our agenda includes trigger for SOX and SOX review, regulators and governing bodies related to SOX, key sections, in sections which are important and are applicable to the public companies, penalties related to not adhering to SOX requirements, COSO framework, SOX methodology, and the way forward. In the end, we will explain you how we can help you to get compliant with the SOX requirements. Moving on to the next slide, which is trigger for SOX. Early during 2001-2002, the world experienced some of the worst financial scandals. Companies like Enron and MCI were involved and they were completely wiped out. They filed for bankruptcy, you know, in the end. And Enron, you know, if I talk about Enron, Enron was a major electricity, natural gas, communication and paper and pulp company with around 30,000 employees. During year 2000, they reported a revenue of around $100 billion. And prior to this period, Fortune has named Enron as America's most innovative company for 6 consecutive years. All this changed at the end of 2001, when it was revealed that Enron's reported financial condition was sustained by institutionalized, systematic, and creatively planned accounting fraud. It has since been known as the Enron scandal. huge debts were kept off the balance sheet by Enron. All this came into light by an internal whistleblower who reported. And the result was shareholders lost around $75 billion, employees lost their jobs, and investors lost their retirement fund. Similarly, the same thing happened with WorldCom in year 2002. WorldCom was a telecommunication company, and its internal audit department uncovered the fraud. WorldCom underreported line costs by capitalizing rather than expensing and inflating revenues by fake accounting entries. And again, billion of dollars and job loss happened. So following these two scandals, the Congress passed the SOX Act, introducing the most sweeping set of new business regulations since early 1930s during that period. In India also, something similar happened and IFCs were introduced. Though we are not talking about IFCs, but I thought, you know, it is relevant to mention that India is also, you know, taking care of SOX related requirement through IFCs. Moving on to the next slide, which is the SOX overview. SOX is the short form of Sarbanes-Oxley Act, which came into existence in 2002. The United States Congress passed the Sarbanes-Oxley Act to protect shareholders and general public from accounting errors and fraudulent practices, and to improve the accuracy of corporate disclosures. Sarbanes-Oxley affect all companies, all public companies, and their wholly owned subsidiaries in the United States and across the globe by requiring them to follow the provisions of the Act. In one sentence, you know, if we define SOX, we can say it is compliance program to evaluate the effectiveness of internal controls over financial reporting. Moving on to the next slide, which is regulator and governing bodies. Regulator and governing bodies for the acts are PCAOB, which is Public Companies Accounting Oversight Board, and Securities Exchange Commission. As per the Act, PCAOB is entrusted with an authority to establish auditing and related professional practice standards to be used by the registered public accounting firms. And SEC has oversight and informance authority over the board, and no rule of board becomes effective without the prior approval of the commission. The PCB in 2003 introduced Accounting Standard 2. It was issued during October 2003, and according to it, audit of internal controls over financial reporting was to be done in conjunction with the audit of financial statements. In the next slide, I have explained AS2 and AS5. AS5 superseded AS2 in 2007. And, you know, I mean, it's the flow that I've tried to explain since 2003. Can we move on to the next slide, Rekha? Yeah. So AS2 was issued in 2003, and according to it, audit of internal controls over financial reporting was in conjunction with the audit of financial statements. The perspective of auditor here, or the focus of auditor, was rule-based, which is, you know, according to the GAAP accounting method. Material weaknesses were based, you know, identified during the audit were based on on different indicators, which were like qualitative assessment and quantitative assessment. And the approach to the, you know, going about SOX compliance was bottom to top, which is like from the lowest level of the, you know, of the subsidiaries to the parent company. This section was superseded by AS5. in 2007. It involved actually, initially when this happened, it involved a lot of cost and a lot of effort. And over a period of time, it was realized that, you know, companies face a lot of difficulties in implementing it. So PCAOB evolved it further and came up with section, which is AS5 in 2007. The management assessment approach here in this section completely changed. From bottom to top approach, it changed to top to down approach, which is like whatever is the material process for the parent company, you know, is considered now to be the material processes for SOX requirements for the subsidiaries. The other thing was that audit of internal controls over financial reporting was now integrated with audit of financial statements. And from principles-based focus, risk assessment was now, risk assessment now, you know, in, under this section begins with the hello.
Yeah, we can hear you, Ashish.
Yeah, risk assessment from it moved to IFRS, which is principle based. And there was an increased focus on fraud and fraud awareness. It also emphasized on the fact that the auditors can now reference, you know, the work of third parties or by or the testing done by the management of the company, which, you know, helped in further reducing the costs for the companies to get SOX compliant. The definition of material weakness also changed from a remotely possible scenario to a reasonable possible scenario in AS5. It was remotely possible in AS2. So this was the, you know, big difference between AS2 and AS5. Currently we have AS5, which is prevalent, and it has also been evolved further with they have kind of introduced 17 principles in 2013, you know, basis which the risk assessment is to be carried out and the controls are to be identified and tested. Moving on to the next slide. The key sections pertaining to the SOX Act are Section 302, Section 404, Section 906, and 409. In 302 talks about management's responsibility for maintaining effective internal controls and disclose all material deficiencies to auditors and audit committee. Quarterly certifications are required from the management and are filed with the SEC. 404 talks about the annual assessment of the effectiveness of internal controls, which is done by an external auditor. The responsibility of doing the assessment is with the management of the company, but it is verified and attested by the external auditor. Section 906 talks about the criminal penalties associated with providing or certifying misleading financial reports or statements. And Section 409 requires the public companies to report on a rapid and current basis any material changes that are happening in, you know, with respect to their operations or the financial condition. So in this webinar, I've tried to explain Section 302 and 404 in detail, which is on the next slide. Can we move on to the next slide? Yeah, coming to Section 302. Section 302 addresses the implementation and certification of disclosure controls and related procedures by the management. So it is the management's responsibility to have an internal controls and integrated internal controls framework in place and to identify and implement those controls and ensure that these controls are being operated smoothly. The CEO and CFO are the main persons, and it is their responsibility. They need to establish and they need to establish and maintain the internal controls. They need to ensure that the appropriateness of the design of the internal controls is such that any material information relating to their organization and their consolidated subsidiaries is made known to them by others within those entities for the period in which the periodic reports are being prepared. That is, it is their, I mean, basically this means is, what this means is that it is the responsibility of the CEO and CFO to ensure that they are aware of what all is happening in the company, irrespective of the fact whether or not, you know, they are directly dealing with it. So they need to have that kind of a framework in place from whereby they are getting informed that yes, everything is being run smoothly. It also requires them to report in their quarter, I mean, a certification is required from their end in the quarterly reports that are filed, commenting on the effectiveness of internal controls, on a regular basis. The report includes their conclusions about the effectiveness and their evaluation as of date. They also need to certify that signing officer has reviewed the report. The report does not contain any untrue statements or has omitted any state or has omitted any, you know, material fact. Financial statements and financial information included in the report fairly represents the financial conditions and results of the operations. Section 404, on the other hand, is a compliance process. It is a much wider section with, you know, and requires more effort than 302. It requires organizations management to write a report stating their responsibility of establishing and maintaining the internal controls and its structure, including assessment and effectiveness of the controls. External audit firm is required to attest on the management's report and also on the assessment and effectiveness of the internal controls. So, I mean, if we talk about the difference between the two, in section 302, it is only the management which is responsible. And in section 404, it is the CEO, CFO, along with the CEO, CFO of the organization, the auditor is also responsible. Can we move on to the next slide now? This is a brief comparison of 302 and 404. The objective of 302 is that it's a certification process. 404 is a compliance process. Frequency of 302 is quarterly, and in case of 404, it is annual. Requirements in 302 are quarterly certification of design and operating effectiveness of controls and disclosure of all known control and deficiencies, disclose acts of fraud. In 404, it requires management to report annually on the effectiveness of ICFR, and independent accountant or the auditing firm has to attest the ICFR. The responsibility lies with the CEO, as I've already explained. In case of 302, it lies with CEO and CFO, and in case of 404, it lies with CEO, CFO, and CEO, CFO, management, and independent auditor all are responsible for 404. Can we move on to the next slide? Section 906 covers the penalties for public companies which are not in compliance or have reported untrue statements are subject to penalties, and these are, you know, criminal penalties. These are criminal penalties which can go upwards of, you know, say about it has got a cash component to it, in the sense that the fines and also 20 years in prison. Anyone convicted of securities fraud may be banned by SEC from holding office and director positions, destroying and altering evidence or otherwise obstructing securities fraud proceedings may be punished with a fine and up to 20 years of prison. And SEC may freeze payments to accused individuals. Any revenge to whistleblowers is also subject to fines and 10 years of imprisonment. Yeah, can you? Yeah. Out here, I've tried to explain the challenges and benefits of SOCs. If I talk about challenges, geographical spread of various organizations over multiple locations is a big hindrance to get the entire, you know, to get the parent company and subsidiaries in compliance with the in compliance with the SOX Act. Cost involved is also very high, and technological changes and adopting to those changes need to be assessed, and how, you know, one can leverage machine learning and other related stuff is important. It is a very complex and dynamic environment under which, you know, everything needs to be identified and settled. But it brings, I mean, implementation of SOX brings its own benefits. It increases transparency. It helps organization to build confidence of investors, of its employees, stakeholders, vendors in the organization. The accountability of management increases, responsibilities are assigned, and ultimately it results in improved effectiveness and efficiency of the controls which have been identified for the organization, whether those are like operational controls or ICFR controls. Can we move on to the next slide? COSO framework. So how do we go about implementing SOX in our organization is something, you know, which is defined, or is something that we need to take care of. COSO framework is something, you know, which has been advised by the SEC. Not advised, it has been blessed by the SECs, or recommended by the or approved by the SEC as to be a good enough integrated internal controls framework which an organization can implement to go about documenting the processes and identification of controls. It has got three objectives, which are compliance, operations, financial reports, and compliance with applicable laws and regulations. The five, I'm not able to see the screen. Anyways, I'll talk about it like that. The five components of COSO are control environment, risk assessment, control activities, information and communication, and monitoring. Control environment requires to set the tone of an organization, or it sets the tone at the top, you know, in an organization. It influences the control consciousness of workers. Factors in the control environment include integrity, ethical values, the operational style of administration, delegation of authority, systems, as well as the processes for managing and developing people in the organization. Risk assessment involves setting up of objectives of the organization. And then basis those objectives, risks are then to be identified. It also involves the process as to how those identified risks would be managed and while managing those risks, you know, consideration should be given for potential for fraudulent behavior. Control activities are the policies and procedures that help to ensure that management directives are carried out. They help to ensure that necessary measures are taken to address the risks that may hinder the achievement of the company's objective. Control objectives are applicable all throughout the organization at all levels. They include a range of activities as diverse as approvals, authorizations, verifications, reconciliations, operational performance, reviews, asset safety, segregation of duties, etc. Third component of the POSO model is information and communication. Information system plays a key role in internal control systems. They produce reports, including, the reports are both operational as well as financial. Compliance related information is also there. In a broader sense, effective communication must ensure information flows in and out from all directions, which is down, across, or up within an organization. Monitoring is the fifth component, and it talks about a regular check by the organization staff or the persons responsible for smooth functioning of the requirements with respect to controls and procedures implemented. Can we move on to the next slide? These are the 17 principles of the POSO framework. This was introduced at a later date, as I've already mentioned, in somewhere around 2013-14. And for each and every component, you know, certain principles are identified. These principles are identified, basis which currently the SOCs, the internal controls over financial reporting are developed and maintained and tested. Along with the POSO, POSO actually takes care of operational as well as financial controls. We also have IT related controls, because in today's scenario, it is very important that we should consider IT systems, you know, which are responsible for processing of information. Equally, COVID framework is something which is again blessed by HCC with respect to, you know, which an organization can have with respect to implementation of IT controls. COVID stands for Control Objectives for Information and Related Technologies. It is an IT management framework developed by Isaka. I think that's all from my side. And now Rekha can take over.
Thanks, Ashish. So to recap till now, we have covered what were the triggers for the SOX, the major corporate scandals, the misleading financial statements that led to the enactment of the SOX Compliance Act in 2002. We also noted that the objective of SOX was to restore public investor confidence and the important concept of the ICOFR, that is internal controls over financial reporting. We looked at the regulators governing bodies, which was the PCAOB, the SEC, the PCAOB for fun, we also call it the peekaboo. And the key sections we went through, the 302 and 404. And we also went through what were the criminal liabilities and penalties, which are huge as 5 million and 20 years and more of imprisonment in case of misleading financial statements. We looked at what were the frameworks that could be adopted in an organization, being the COSO and COBIT, which were some, the COSO was for your operational and financial controls, and the COBIT was for your IT framework. So all organizations can adopt it, you know, when you want to have the internal controls implemented. So moving on, I would be taking you through the Sarbanes-Oxley methodology and some of the practical aspects involved here. So like you can see the flowchart, it gives a picture from start to end of the activities involved, starting you know, from planning and scoping, process documentation, design assessment, and then you move on to the control testing process, and finally you would have the remediation and reporting. So this is the whole workflow, and it gives a gist of the whole process end to end. So planning the first step, and as we all know, planning is important. In all cases, a good plan is half the work done. So effective scoping reduces total effort required for completing the SOX project. And you would also consider it the most cost beneficial, scoping result, like when you are scoping, what would give you the best result. So depending on the materiality threshold, misstatements, materiality, I think they're all familiar with it. So it is misstatements that individually or when aggregated with others could have a material effect on the financial statements are considered for each organization. Basis of the materiality, we scope in the business units, the geographical location, and significant accounts. So that would be your planning and scoping. The next step would be to update the process documentation. There must be already an existing process documentation, the as-is process. So this is conducted. This is done by conducting interviews with process owners, conducting walkthroughs, and during this process we identify the existing controls, and where there are gaps identified, the control design is remediated. So basically the whole process documentation and design assessment is to assess the controls, what controls are in place, and whether if there are gaps, you fill in those controls. The next step would be to test if the controls are operating effectively as they are intended to. So the controls that we designed, are they operating effectively? So this is what we test, and the gaps identified are remediated and retested. So the last step would be reporting, which includes the management's assessment of ICOFR and the auditor's attestation to management's assessment. In the following slides, we'll be going in more detail for each of these activities: planning, process documentation, control testing, and reporting. So we've already talked about planning and scoping, how it is important, and how basis the materiality threshold. We are going to consider the significant accounts, processes, and locations. So like Ashish mentioned, for the AS5, the top-down approach now is, we've just put this as an important concept here, how scoping, it also helps in scoping and reaching to your levels of controls. So this is the second activity, the documentation and design assessment after scoping. So like we discussed that we document the as-is process throughout the organization. And this can be in the form of a narrative, like a Word document, and a pictorial way also could be a flowchart highlighting the control activity. We then assess the gaps in controls and determine appropriate steps to remediate the control gaps. So this is another important concept, and the financial statement assertions. These are representations made by management on financial statement, and they could be explicit or implicit. So the assertions are used to determine the risks by considering the different types of potential error that could occur. And then you design controls in response to those risks to cover the financial statement assertions. So as appearing on the screen, the five financial statement assertions applicable to your income statement, your balance sheet, and your notes. So we have the existence, you know, we have these assertions that your balance sheet is complete, the assets exist, and the assets are valued appropriately, and the assets that the company owns, they have a right to it. So the management is claiming all these assertions, but we have to see what, as you know, as a SOX auditor, what can be the risk here. We would say that whether the record is complete. So we put controls to check the completeness. So for completeness assertion, we are going to check whether all the transactions are recorded. And like for existence, we'll see that the assets on the financial statements actually exist. And by valuation, for example, we're seeing that all the assets and liabilities are included at appropriate amounts. Moving on to the next slide, we've tried to give you a walkthrough process. This is usually done like it's usually a one-time activity. You're trying to confirm the process, and it is also to confirm your control documentation. So it's a step-by-step, it takes you through the whole accounting system from its inception to the final disposition. If there is a change in the way of a process was being done earlier, which could be due to a new system or a recent acquisition or a change in personnel, all these changes are highlighted, and you see how it needs to be, your controls need to be updated based on this change. So we've given you pointers, what's broken, what's new, and what has changed. And the walkthrough process, you actually sit with the process owner and walk through the whole thing and obtain documents, screenshots, evidences, and you conform to the process. We've also tried to include a risk control matrix sample. It is a repository of risk listed, which are assessed by each organization, as well as the controls in place to mitigate those risks. It is an important tool as it provides all information in a tabular form. Like we can see here, there's a, you're talking about the process, the sub-process, risk, control, what are the financial statements, assertions applicable, and even the COSO component is being covered. So it gives you a whole picture. Here we are also talking about frequency of the control activity. So, if the activity is happening monthly, weekly, quarterly, basis which we also determine the sample size. So for example, the weekly, if the activity is performed weekly, we usually choose a sample size of 5, but that again is a SOX, methodology for each organization. What do they want to, adopt as a sample size, and they are comfortable with it. Also, it's talking about the control method, the manual automated. So an automated control would only be a test of one. So we're trying to say that if it works for one, it works for all. After we have the scoping and the control design, we're moving on to the control testing and reporting to test whether the controls that are designed are operating effectively as intended. So we're saying that yes, we do have a control, but is it operating? We use a test script, usually in an Excel format, and we say, okay, this is our control, and we list down the set of test procedures and we obtain evidence, you know, it could be by way of inquiry, observation. So we need to get comfortable with the control, and then we kind of put our test results and conclude. For the deficiency identified, we prepare a remediation plan in discussion with the process owner, and it is retested again once, you know, after the particular period we said that it would be remediated in, we go back and retest it. So we try to give you a whole, you know, the difference between a design effectiveness versus the operating effectiveness. The design is like for the control design, and the operating effectiveness is test of controls. We just wanted to highlight this concept here. Also, we already went through you know, AS5, where it redefined significant deficiency and material weakness. So basically, once you find a gap, it's your control deficiency. So if your control is not operating as intended, that is, it is not able to prevent or detect misstatements on a timely basis, then we have a control deficiency. So a deficiency, you know, the like how it shows the picture, it is in the reverse order, like its impact. So the material weakness is actually the highest. Then we have the significant deficiency, and the control deficiency is the one which we've identified. So we're saying, so a deficiency or a combination of deficiencies could result in a significant or material weakness. So when it is a significant deficiency, we're saying that, you know, it is not as material as the material weakness, but it is significant enough that it needs to be brought up to the management. So we're saying that the management is to report significant deficiencies to the audit committee. And for material weakness, this was, you know, we're saying that if there is a reasonable possibility that a material misstatement of the company's annual or interim financial statements will not be prevented or detected, then you know, we have a material weakness, and this is reported by your external auditor, and even the report would be an adverse opinion. So it is less, if it is a less severe than a material weakness, then it becomes a significant deficiency, and otherwise it's just a control deficiency. So that kind of brings us like to the whole process of you know, scoping, documentation, control design, test of controls, and then here we have evaluative and reporting. So moving on. So with all the technologies that we are all aware of, the digitization and the data analytics, so it only makes sense to make you know, SOX compliance also smarter. So we've already seen at a lot of clients where data analytics is already being used. There is some part of RPA that's also, you know, the robotics that also has been initiated. You know, instead of where we were just able to check a few transactions, we are able to cover 100% of the account testing. So that's a huge benefit, but of course it comes with its own challenges that right now we don't, you know, the skill sets available are not so many, and even if they are, they could be a little expensive. But yes, it is encouraged and it's recommended that organizations should start, at least begin using data analytics and automate process approval to make the process more efficient. So that is the way forward. We're also taking you through an important concept of the external auditor's reliance on management testing. So this is, you know, the concept is similar to using the work of others. So here the external auditor should be able to rely on the work done by our internal auditors, by us. And that way, you know, it's a judgment call by the external auditor that if they are able to kind of, you know, have a, like, judge the if they're comfortable with all the competence of the team, the management and its team, then they will be able to rely on our internal controls. And so we can reduce the amount of testing the external auditor would be doing. So that way, you know, the cost for the organization is much lesser. We all know how external auditors' fee is. So basically here, we should definitely have good documentation, key controls identified, test procedures. We should be able to evidence, you know, how we are satisfying that the key controls are operating effectively. So this is one place where we can actually work well to reduce our compliance cost. So that's it from our end. We're closing on how RiskPro can help you. We can help you with the development of the framework, help you with the, you know, pulling out a risk control matrix, assessing your risk controls, help you test. And also we have an automated SOX reporting tool. The tool is very helpful. It's like help standardize various processes and documentation. It helps and also reporting, like, you know, it shows what's the stage of each SOX control. Is it, you know, effective? What's the remediation date? So it gives an overall picture. So yeah, this is how RiskPro can help you. And this is what we have for you. So we are open for questions now. Oh, I'm not able to see any questions, Anita. Are you able to see?
Yes. So I'll just start reading out the questions to you. The first question we have is, what were the methods used to increase focus on fraud and awareness?
Okay, so that would also be in your scoping and planning stage itself. You would, you know, you'll see each process, how susceptible it is to fraud, and you kind of have your, assess your fraud risk and have a control for it and test it. So it'll be in your scoping itself where you will identify the processes which are more susceptible to fraud. Hope this answers your question.
All right, the next question is 302 mandatory certification and how is it evidenced?
Ashish, you want to answer that?
Yeah, I'll take that question. 302 is, you know, for any public company which is listed with SEC, it is mandatory. And every quarter, the CEO and CFO have to comment on the structure of the internal controls and their operating effectiveness. They need to certify it, you know, when they file their quarterly reports, they need to certify that we are aware of the fact as to, you know, that these are the internal controls in place. We have adequate internal controls in place, which can timely notify us if there is any problem with respect to any processes, and that can impact the financial statements. And if the problem has been identified, we have taken account of all that, and the financial statements do not reflect any wrong information.
All right, so the next question we have is, COSO includes internal control framework, which includes ICFR guidelines as well. Is that a correct statement?
No, that is not a correct statement. COSO in itself is an integrated internal control framework. It's a guideline. So can you repeat the question again?
Sure. It says COSO includes internal control framework, which includes ICFR guidelines as well. Is that a correct statement?
Okay. I mean, it doesn't include any ICFR guidelines. ICFR is something, you know, which is again, you know, I told you that the governing body for ICFR is the SEC. And COSO is an integrated internal controls framework, which was introduced in 1992. And then some changes happened and a new version came in 1994. So SEC says that the organization should have an adequate internal control framework in place, whereby the information is, you know, which is gathered or is coming to the CEO and CFO or the management can be relied upon. I mean, nobody at a later stage can say that, you know, I was not doing this and I'm not aware of it. This was a very menial job. Say somebody, an accounting clerk was responsible for it. They are saying the accountability and responsibility of the financial reporting rests with the CEO and CFO. And they need to have an internal control framework in place whereby they can very comfortably say that whatever is being reported is accurate. And for that, the COSO framework can be used to implement, to design and implement controls.
Yeah, just to add that the you know, the framework is used to achieve the objective of internal controls over your financial reporting. So yeah, it is to achieve that objective. Okay, we can move on.
All right. The next question is to what extent these provisions are applicable to private limited companies?
They're not applicable at all. It is only for public listed companies.
All right. Then we have another question. How to prepare the checklist for SOX compliance in 302 and 404?
Okay, so that's very procedural. I mean, it's usually like each company's methodology, but yes, RiskPro can help you develop a checklist. So, you know, it'll have your planning, what are your, pointers below that, and then you'll have your control design. So there is possibility of a checklist and then test results and your test procedures. So it is procedural and it can be developed.
All right, and we have another question. Can the scope for testing based on materiality differ process wise, or is it applicable for all the processes?
I mean, it's a very twisted question. So once it is in scope, you know, you'll have to test it thoroughly to so that it does not give, you know, it does a fair presentation of your financial statements. So based on materiality, if you've chosen a process, you've chosen an account statement, you need to test it thoroughly. You'd be testing it to be comfortable. So.
All right, and we have one more question. What would be your approach if the organization is using well-known ERPs like Oracle or SAP?
I mean, all of them are using well-known ERPs. So you just have to, maybe there are like a lot of automation in that. Maybe there might be a lot of automated controls. So that would be a judgment call, like, you know, reviewing. But I think at this age of technology, I think everyone is using a ERP.
All right. Has any company or bank ever reported changes in their financial standing in their reports, or maybe any US companies if SOX is not applicable for India?
I haven't understood that question.
Would you like me to read it?
Yeah.
Has any company or bank ever reported changes in their financial standing in their reports? Or maybe any US companies if SOX is not applicable for India?
Okay, the question is not very clear. I don't know what financial standing means, but yes, if there are material weaknesses that have been reported, and I don't know what India means. If India is a subsidiary, it's material and it's scoped in, SOX would be applicable to it. Yeah.
All right. And another question. Practically, CEO, CFO certification is based on back-to-back certification for which checklist items are already provided by the CFO. So doesn't it lead to majority checklist approach only on a quarterly basis?
I wouldn't agree to that. I don't think it's back to back. It's every quarter, and it's in the beginning of the year itself. You already have your plan, which controls you would be testing. So the checklist just helps you, you know, check those controls and provide a result and a conclusion. So it's not just checklist based. It's just checklist is just a tool to help you do the SOX testing. But yeah, you will have to conclude. You will have to you know, use judgment and you have to use judgment, test procedures, everything. So it's just not a very checklist approach. Yeah.
All right. Then kindly explain with the help of examples how you segregated control deficiency, material weakness, etc.
Yeah, so we actually had this very good slide, which we covered it efficiently, we thought. So any gap that you have identified would be a control deficiency. And, you know, if it is the combination of those deficiencies or just that control deficiency is so big that, you know, it is not going to lead to any misstatement of your financial statements, but it is... you know, material enough. So the management takes it to the audit committee and it needs to be fixed and remediated. So right now I can't think of any example, but yes, I mean, if that deficiency is not leading to a material misstatement, then it is not a material weakness.
All right. Do we need to perform IFC test at the end or during the course of the audit?
Management has to perform the tests all throughout the year, every quarter. You know, when they are filing their 10Q reports, they need to give it this certification. So the testing generally happens all throughout the year. In some organizations, people do it at the end of the year, but then, you know, the if the controls are like functioning properly and the control structure is adequate, say, you know, once you've implemented SOX, and it's been a while that you are actually, you know, going about the certifications. Then in those cases, the CEO, CFO certifies every quarter, but testing ideally should be done on a quarterly basis, which the CEO and CFO will get confidence, and then they can easily say that everything is running fine. People have different processes, you know, they have kind of identified all the critical processes and they have process owners and respective, you know, the controls in the process, they have control owners for those. So when you do the testing, you come to know which control has failed. And that's how, you know, people come to know as to which control is operating fine and which and where the problem is. So that is it, you know. I mean, if you ask, testing is to be done quarterly and together, you know, at the end of the year, the external auditor will come and report on that testing. We'll do it a little bit of, you know, own testing and we'll comment on it. That's about it.
All right. Up to what extent are the SOX COSO requirements integrated with aligned with the Indian auditing standards so as to eliminate the duplication of efforts in internal control and risk assessment?
Can you repeat the question?
Sure. Up to what extent are the SOX or COSO requirements integrated with or aligned with the Indian auditing standards so as to eliminate the duplication of efforts in internal control and risk assessment?
See, in India, we don't have, we have IFCs. We don't have Sarbanes-Oxley Act. An IFC is a combination of, you know, IC, internal controls over financial reporting plus fraud prevention controls plus operation controls. So when we talk about implementing IFCs in India, we take care of all these controls and we implement. In SOX, operational controls are altogether different. To an extent, operational controls also overlap with your SOX controls, and those controls are taken into consideration. So it, you know, we have to go by the specific requirement at both the places, and accordingly develop our own risk control framework to go about internal controls over financial reporting, testing, and all.
Right, we have time just for one last question. Is the COSO framework, will it help to prepare a checklist on fraud analysis or find out the fraudulent activities in an organization? What is the major role of the COSO framework in identification of frauds within an organization?
The COSO framework actually gives you these steps that are to be undertaken to have an internal controls framework. And when you talk about fraud, fraud also happens because of, you know, say when it, a person can do a fraud on his own also, you know, and also in association with other people. So when you are actually identifying the risks for a process, you got to take into account everything, you know, the risk, the control risks. There are different type of risks that you have to take into account, and fraud risks are just, you know, one part of it. So basis the model which has been given by COSO, you can do the risk assessment and create controls to prevent fraud. Most like, you know, a very easy example for this would be segregation of duties. So chances of fraud reduces considerably if you have got segregation of duties, like one person is a maker checker thing. And that's how, you know, the model can actually help in having the controls for the fraud.
All right. Thank you very much. We would have to conclude the webinar. We've run out of time now. So Rekha and Ashish, thank you very much for your time and for sharing insights on today's SOX webinar. And thank you to all the participants for joining us today. Have a great day. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.